This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The causes of World War I remain controversial and debated questions. The war began in the Balkans in late July 1914 and ended in November 1918, leaving 17 million dead and 20 million wounded. A long-term analysis of its origins seeks to explain why two rival sets of powers, Germany and Austria-Hungary on the one hand, and Russia, France, Serbia and Great Britain on the other, had come into conflict by 1914. It examines political, territorial and economic conflicts, militarism, a complex web of alliances and alignments, imperialism, the growth of nationalism, and the power vacuum created by the decline of the Ottoman Empire. Other important long-term or structural factors were unresolved territorial disputes, the perceived breakdown of the balance of power in Europe, convoluted and fragmented governance, the arms races of the previous decades, and military planning. A short-term analysis focuses on why the conflicting sets of powers went to war when they did. The immediate causes lay in decisions made by statesmen and generals during the July Crisis of 1914, triggered by the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand of Austria and his wife, Sophie, Duchess of Hohenberg. On 28 June 1914, the assassin, Gavrilo Princip, was an ethnic Serb and Yugoslav nationalist from the group Young Bosnia, which was supported by the Black Hand, a nationalist organization in Serbia. The crisis escalated as the conflict between Austria-Hungary and Serbia came to involve Russia, Germany, France, and ultimately Belgium and Great Britain. Other factors that came into play during the diplomatic crisis that preceded the war included misperceptions of intent, e.g., the German belief that Britain would remain neutral, fatalism that war was inevitable, and the speed of the crisis, which was exacerbated by delays and misunderstandings in diplomatic communications. The crisis followed a series of diplomatic clashes among the great powers Italy, France, Germany, Britain, Austria-Hungary and Russia over European and colonial issues in the decades before 1914 that had left tensions high. In turn, these public clashes can be traced to changes in the balance of power in Europe since 1867. Consensus on the origins of the war remains elusive since historians disagree on key factors, and place differing emphasis on a variety of factors. This is compounded by changing historical arguments over time, particularly the delayed availability of classified historical archives, and differing geographic zeitgeist. Then prevailing, the deepest distinction among historians is between those who focus on the action of Germany and Austria-Hungary as key and those who focus on a wider group of actors. Secondary fault lines exist between those who believe that Germany deliberately planned a European war, those who believe that the war was ultimately unplanned but still caused principally by Germany and Austria-Hungary taking risks, and those who believe that either all or some of the other powers, namely Russia, France, Serbia and Great Britain, played a more significant role in causing the war than has been traditionally suggested. Contents: 1. Polarization of Europe, 1887-1914-11. German realignment to Austria-Hungary and Russian realignment to France, 1887-1892-12. French revanchist foreign policy towards Germany. 13. British alignment towards France and Russia, 1898-1907, the Triple Entente. 14. First Moroccan crisis, 1905-06, strengthening the Entente. 15. Bosnian crisis, 1908, worsening relations of Russia and Serbia with Austria-Hungary. 16. Second Moroccan crisis, 1911, the Entente holds again. 17. Italo-Turkish War, abandonment of the Ottomans, 1911-12-18. Balkan Wars, 1912-13, growth of Serbian and Russian power. 19. Franco-Russian alliance changes, the Balkan inception scenario, 1911-1913-110. Anglo-German détente, 1912-14. The 2nd of July crisis, the chain of events. 21. Assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand by Serbian irredentists, the 28th of June 1914. 22. Austria edges towards war with Serbia. 23. Blank check, Germany supports Austria-Hungary. 24. Fermete, France backs Russia. 25. Russia mobilizes, the crisis escalates. 26. Serbia rejects the ultimatum, Austria declares war on Serbia. 27. Russia, general mobilization is ordered. 28. German mobilization and war with Russia and France. 29. Britain declares war on Germany, 4 August 1914. 3. Domestic political factors. 31. German domestic politics. 32 French domestic politics 33 The drivers of Austro-Hungarian policy 34 Imperialism 35 Social Darwinism 36 Web of alliances 37 Arms race 371 Anglo-German naval race 372 Russian interests in Balkans and Ottoman Empire 4 Technical and military factors 41 The short war illusion 42 Primacy of the offensive and war by timetable 43 Schlieffen-Moltke plan 5 Historiography 6 See also 7 Notes 8 Citations 9 References 10 Further reading 101 Historiography 102 Primary sources 11 External links Polarization of Europe, 1887-1914 To understand the long-term origins of the war in 1914 it is essential to understand how the powers formed into two competing sets sharing common aims and enemies these two sets became, by August 1914, Germany and Austria-Hungary on the one hand and Russia, France, Serbia and Great Britain on the other German realignment to Austria-Hungary and Russian realignment to France France, 1887-1892 Indiana 1887, German and Russian alignment was secured by means of a secret reinsurance treaty arranged by Otto von Bismarck however, in 1890 the treaty was allowed to lapse in favor of the dual alliance 1879 between Germany and Austria-Hungary in response Russia secured the Franco-Russian alliance in 1892, which was to last until 1917 French revanchist foreign policy towards Germany this section does not cite any sources please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources unsourced material may be challenged and removed September 2016 learn how and when to remove this template message. French Emperor Napoleon III left as prisoner of Bismarck right in the Franco-Prussian War some of the distant origins of World War I can be seen in the results and consequences of the Franco-Prussian War in 1870-71 and the concurrent unification of Germany Germany had won decisively and established a powerful empire, while France went into chaos and military decline for years a legacy of animosity grew between France and Germany following the German annexation of Alsace-Lorraine the annexation caused widespread resentment in France, giving rise to the desire for revenge, known as revanchism. French sentiments wanted to avenge military and territorial losses and the displacement of France as the preeminent continental military power. French defeat in the war had sparked political instability, culminating in a revolution and the formation of the French Third Republic. Bismarck was wary of French desire for revenge. He achieved peace by isolating France and balancing the ambitions of Austria-Hungary and Russia in the Balkans. During his later years, he tried to placate the French by encouraging their overseas expansion however, anti-German sentiment remained a Franco-German colonial entente that was made in 1884 in protest of an Anglo-Portuguese agreement in West Africa proved short-lived after a pro-imperialist government under Jules Ferry in France fell in 1885 France eventually recovered from its defeat, paid its war indemnity, and rebuilt its military strength again but it was smaller than Germany in terms of population, and thus felt insecure next to its more powerful neighbor British alignment towards France and Russia, 1898-1907, the Triple Entente Britain abandoned the policy of holding aloof from the continental powers, so-called splendid isolation. In the 1900s after being isolated during the Boer War Britain concluded agreements, limited to colonial affairs, with her two major colonial rivals, the Entente Cordiale with France in 1904 and the Anglo-Russian Entente of 1907 some historians see Britain's alignment as principally a reaction to an assertive German foreign policy and the buildup of its navy from 1898 which led to the Anglo-German naval arms race others, most notably Niall Ferguson, argue that Britain chose France and Russia over Germany because Germany was too weak an ally to provide an effective counterbalance to the other powers and could not provide Britain with the imperial security achieved by the Entente agreements in the words of British diplomat Arthur Nicholson it was far more disadvantageous to us to have an unfriendly France and Russia than an unfriendly Germany. Ferguson argues that the British government rejected German alliance overtures not because Germany began to pose a threat to Britain, but, on the contrary, because they realized she did not pose a threat. The impact of the Triple Entente was therefore twofold, to improve British relations with France and her ally Russia and to demote the importance to Britain of good relations with Germany it was not that antagonism toward Germany caused its isolation, but rather that the new system itself channeled an intensified hostility towards the German Empire. The so-called Triple Entente between Britain, France and Russia is often compared to the Triple Alliance between Germany, Austria-Hungary and Italy, but historians caution against the comparison. The Entente, in contrast to the Triple Alliance or the Franco-Russian Alliance, was not an alliance of mutual defense, and Britain therefore felt free to make her own foreign policy decisions in 1914, as British Foreign Office official Air Crow minuted. The fundamental fact, of course, is that the Entente is not an alliance for purposes of ultimate emergency. It may be found to have no substance at all, for the Entente is nothing more than a frame of mind, a view of general policy which is shared by the governments of two countries, but which may be, or become, so vague as to lose all content. A series of diplomatic incidents between 1905 and 1914 heightened tensions between the great powers and reinforced the existing alignments, beginning with the First Moroccan Crisis, 1905-06, strengthening the Entente. The First Moroccan Crisis, also known as the Tangier Crisis, was an international crisis between March 1905 and May 1906 over the status of Morocco. The crisis worsened German relations with both France and the United Kingdom, and helped ensure the success of the new Anglo-French Entente Cordiale. In the words of historian Christopher Clark, the Anglo-French Entente was strengthened rather than weakened by the German challenge to France in Morocco. Bosnian Crisis, 1908, worsening relations of Russia and Serbia with Austria-Hungary. In 1908, Austria-Hungary announced its annexation of Bosnia and Herzegovina, dual provinces in the Balkan region of Europe formerly under the control of the Ottoman Empire, though Bosnia and Herzegovina were still nominally under the control of the Ottoman Sultan. In 1908, Austria-Hungary had administered the provinces since the Congress of Berlin in 1878, when the great powers of Europe awarded the dual monarchy the right to occupy the two provinces, with the legal title to remain with Turkey. The announcement in October 1908 of Austria-Hungary's annexation of Bosnia and Herzegovina upset the fragile balance of power in the Balkans, enraging Serbia and Pan-Slavic nationalists throughout Europe. Though weakened, Russia was forced to submit to its humiliation. Its foreign office still viewed Austria-Hungary's actions as overly aggressive and threatening. Russia's response was to encourage pro-Russian, anti-Austrian sentiment in Serbia and other Balkan provinces, provoking Austrian fears of Slavic expansionism in the region. Second Moroccan Crisis, 1911, the Entente holds again. The Agadir Crisis, also called the Second Moroccan Crisis or the Pantherspring, was the international tension sparked by the deployment of a substantial force of French troops in the interior of Morocco in April 1911. Germany reacted by sending the gunboat SMS Panther to the Moroccan port of Agadir on 1 July 1911. Rather than scaring Britain into turning toward Germany, increased fear and hostility drew Britain closer to France. British backing of France during the crisis reinforced the Entente between the two countries and with Russia as well, increasing Anglo-German estrangement, deepening the divisions which would culminate in World War I. Significantly for the events of August 1914, the crisis led British Foreign Secretary Edward Grey and France to make a secret naval agreement where the Royal Navy promised to protect the northern coast of France from German attack, while France concentrated her fleet in the western Mediterranean and agreed to protect British interests there. France was thus able to guard her communications with her North African colonies, and Britain to concentrate more force in home waters to oppose the German high seas fleet. The cabinet was not informed of this agreement until August 1914. Italo-Turkish War, abandonment of the Ottomans, 1911-12. The Italo-Turkish or Turco-Italian War, Turkish, Trablugarp-Savassi, Tripolitanian War, also known in Italy as Guerra di Libia, Libyan War, was fought between the Ottoman Empire and the Kingdom of Italy from September 29, 1911, to October 18, 1912. As a result of this conflict, Italy captured the Ottoman Tripolitania Vilayet province, of which the most notable sub-provinces Sanjaks were Fasan, Cyrenaica, and Tripoli itself. These territories together formed what became known as Italian Libya. The main significance for the First World War was that this war made it clear that no great power appeared to wish to support the Ottoman Empire any longer, and this paved the way for the Balkan Wars. Christopher Clark stated, Italy launched a war of conquest on an African province of the Ottoman Empire, triggering a chain of opportunistic assaults on Ottoman territories across the Balkans. The system of geographical balances that had enabled local conflicts to be contained was swept away. Balkan Wars, 1912-13, growth of Serbian and Russian power. The Balkan Wars were two conflicts that took place in the Balkan Peninsula in southeastern Europe in 1912 and 1913. Four Balkan states defeated the Ottoman Empire in the First War. One of the four, Bulgaria, was defeated in the Second War. The Ottoman Empire lost nearly all of its holdings in Europe. Austria-Hungary, although not a combatant, was weakened as a much enlarged Serbia pushed for union of the South Slavic peoples. The Balkan Wars in 1912-1913 increased international tension between the Russian Empire and Austria-Hungary. It also led to a strengthening of Serbia and a weakening of the Ottoman Empire and Bulgaria, who might otherwise have kept Serbia under control, thus disrupting the balance of power in Europe in favor of Russia. Russia initially agreed to avoid territorial changes, but later in 1912 supported Serbia's demand for an Albanian port. An international conference was held in London in 1912-1913 where it was agreed to create an independent Albania. However, both Serbia and Montenegro refused to comply after an Austrian, and then an international, naval demonstration in early 1912 and Russia's withdrawal of support. Serbia backed down. Montenegro was not as compliant, and on May 2, the Austrian Council of Ministers met and decided to give Montenegro a last chance to comply and, if it would not, then to resort to military action. However, seeing the Austrian military preparations, the Montenegrins requested the ultimatum be delayed and complied. The Serbian government, having failed to get Albania, now demanded that the other spoils of the First Balkan War be reapportioned, and Russia failed to pressure Serbia to back down. Serbia and Greece allied against Bulgaria, which responded with a preemptive strike against their forces. Beginning the Second Balkan War, the Bulgarian army crumbled quickly when Turkey and Romania joined the war. The Balkan Wars strained the German-Austro-Hungarian alliance. The attitude of the German government to Austrian requests of support against Serbia was initially both divided and inconsistent. After the German Imperial War Council of 8 December 1912, it was clear that Germany was not ready to support Austria-Hungary in a war against Serbia and her likely allies. In addition, German diplomacy before, during, and after the Second Balkan War was pro-Greek and pro-Romanian and in opposition to Austria-Hungary's increasingly pro-Bulgarian views. The result was tremendous damage to Austro-German relations. Austrian Foreign Minister Leopold von Berchtold remarked to German Ambassador Heinrich von Schirschke in July 1913 that Austria-Hungary might as well belong to the other grouping for all the good Berlin had been. In September 1913, it was learned that Serbia was moving into Albania and Russia was doing nothing to restrain it. While the Serbian government would not guarantee to respect Albania's territorial integrity and suggested there would be some frontier modifications in October 1913, the Council of Ministers decided to send Serbia a warning followed by an ultimatum, that Germany and Italy be notified of some action and asked for support, and that spies be sent to report if there was an actual withdrawal. Serbia responded to the warning with defiance, and the ultimatum was dispatched on October 17 and received the following day. It demanded that Serbia evacuate Albanian territory within 8 days. Serbia complied, and the Kaiser made a congratulatory visit to Vienna to try to fix some of the damage done earlier in the year. By this time, Russia had mostly recovered from its defeat in the Russo-Japanese War, and the calculations of Germany and Austria were driven by a fear that Russia would eventually become too strong to be challenged. Their conclusion was that any war with Russia had to occur within the next few years in order to have any chance of success. Franco-Russian alliance changes, the Balkan inception scenario, 1911-1913. The original Franco-Russian alliance was formed to protect both France and Russia from a German attack. In the event of such an attack, both states would mobilize in tandem, placing Germany under the threat of a two-front war. However, there were limits placed on the alliance so that it was essentially defensive in character. Throughout the 1890s and the 1900s, the French and the Russians made clear the limits of the alliance did not extend to provocations caused by the other's adventurous foreign policy. For example, Russia warned France that the alliance may not operate if the French provoked the Germans in North Africa. Equally, the French insisted to the Russians that they should not use the alliance to provoke Austria-Hungary or Germany in the Balkans, and that France did not recognize in the Balkans a vital strategic interest for France or for Russia. In the last 18 to 24 months before the outbreak of the war, this changed at the end of 1911 and particularly during the Balkans wars themselves in 1912-13. The French view changed. France now accepted the importance of the Balkans to Russia. Moreover, France clearly stated that if, as a result of a conflict in the Balkans, war were to break out between Austria-Hungary and Serbia, France would stand by Russia. Thus the Franco-Russian alliance changed in character, and by a consequence of that Serbia became a security salient for Russia and France as they bought into the future scenario of a war of Balkan inception. Regardless of who started such a war, the alliance would respond nonetheless. It would view this conflict as a casus foederis, as a trigger for the alliance. Christopher Clark described this change as a very important development in the pre-war system which made the events of 1914 possible. Anglo-German détente, 1912-14. Historians caution that, taken together, the preceding crisis should not be seen as an argument that a European war was inevitable in 1914. Significantly, the Anglo-German naval race was over by 1912. In April 1913, Britain and Germany signed an agreement over the African territories of the Portuguese Empire, which was expected to collapse imminently. Moreover, the Russians were threatening British interests in Persia and India to the extent that in 1914, there were signs that the British were cooling in their relations with Russia and that an understanding with Germany might be useful. The British were deeply annoyed by St. Petersburg's failure to observe the terms of the agreement struck in 1907 and began to feel an arrangement of some kind with Germany might serve as a useful corrective. British diplomat Arthur Nicholson wrote in May 1914, "Since I have been at the Foreign Office I have not seen such calm waters." July crisis, the chain of events. June 28, 1914, Serbian irredentists assassinate Archduke Franz Ferdinand of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. June 30, Austrian Foreign Minister Count Leopold Berchtold and Emperor Franz Joseph agree that the policy of patience with Serbia was at an end and a firm line must be taken. July 5, Austrian diplomat Alexander, Count of Hoyos, visits Berlin to ascertain German attitudes. July 6, Germany provides unconditional support to Austria-Hungary, the so-called blank check. July 20-23, French President Raymond Poincaré, on state visit to the Tsar at St. Petersburg, urges intransigent opposition to any Austrian measure against Serbia. July 23, Austria-Hungary, following their own secret enquiry, sends an ultimatum to Serbia containing their demands, and gave only 48 hours to comply. July 24, Sir Edward Grey, speaking for the British government, asks that Germany, France, Italy and Great Britain, who had no direct interests in Serbia, should act together for the sake of peace simultaneously. July 24, Serbia seeks support from Russia and Russia advises Serbia not to accept the ultimatum. Germany officially declares support for Austria's position. July 24, Russian Council of Ministers agrees secret partial mobilization of the Russian army and navy. July 25, Tsar approves Council of Ministers' decision and Russia begins partial mobilization of 11 million men against the Austrian-Hungarian Empire. July 25, Serbia responds to Austro-Hungarian démarche with less than full acceptance and asks that the Hague Tribunal arbitrate. Austria-Hungary breaks diplomatic relations with Serbia. Serbia mobilizes its army. July 26, Serbian reservists accidentally violate Austro-Hungarian border at Teams Cuban. July 26, a meeting is organized to take place between ambassadors from Great Britain, Germany, Italy and France to discuss the crisis. Germany declines the invitation. July 28, Austria-Hungary, having failed to accept Serbia's response of the 25th, declares war on Serbia. Austro-Hungarian mobilization against Serbia begins. July 29, Sir Edward Grey appeals to Germany to intervene to maintain peace. July 29, the British ambassador in Berlin, Sir Edward Goschen, is informed by the German Chancellor that Germany is contemplating war with France, and furthermore, wishes to send its army through Belgium. He tries to secure Britain's neutrality in such an action. July 29, in the morning, Russian general mobilization against Austria and Germany is ordered. In the evening, the Tsar chooses for partial mobilization after a flurry of telegrams with Kaiser Wilhelm. July 30, Russian general mobilization is reordered by the Tsar on instigation by Sergei Sazonov. July 31, Austrian general mobilization is ordered. July 31, Germany enters a period preparatory to war. July 31, Germany sends an ultimatum to Russia, demanding that they halt general mobilization within 12 hours, but Russia refuses. July 31, both France and Germany are asked by Britain to declare their support for the ongoing neutrality of Belgium. France agrees to this. Germany does not respond. July 31, Germany asks France whether it would stay neutral in case of a war Germany versus Russia. August 1, German general mobilization is ordered. Deployment plan Off-March 2 West chosen. August 1, French general mobilization is ordered. Deployment plan 17 chosen. August 1, Germany declares war against Russia. August 1, the Tsar responds to the King's telegram, stating, I would gladly have accepted your proposals had not the German ambassador this afternoon presented a note to my government declaring war. August 2, Germany and the Ottoman Empire sign a secret treaty entrenching the Ottoman-German alliance. August 3, Germany, after France declines see note its demand to remain neutral, declares war on France. Germany states to Belgium that she would treat her as an enemy if she did not allow free passage of German troops across her lands. August 4, Germany implements offensive operation inspired by Schlieffen plan. August 4, midnight, having failed to receive notice from Germany assuring the neutrality of Belgium, Britain declares war on Germany. August 6, Austria-Hungary declares war on Russia. August 23, Japan, honoring the Anglo-Japanese alliance, declares war on Germany. August 25, Japan declares war on Austria-Hungary. Assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand by Serbian irredentists, 28 June 1914. On 28 June 1914, Archduke Franz Ferdinand of Austria, heir presumptive to the Austro-Hungarian throne, and his wife, Sophie, Duchess of Hohenberg, were shot dead in Sarajevo by Gavrilo Princip, one of a group of six assassins, five Serbs and one Bosniak coordinated by Danilo Ilić, a Bosnian Serb and a member of the Black Hand Secret Society. The assassination is significant because it was perceived by Austria-Hungary as an existential challenge to her and in her view provided a casus belli with Serbia. Moreover, the Archduke, who had been a decisive voice for peace in the previous years, had now been removed. From the discussions, the assassination triggered the July crisis, which turned a local conflict into a European, and then a worldwide, war. Austria edges towards war with Serbia. The assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand, the heir apparent to the Austrian throne, sent deep shockwaves through Austrian elites, and the murder has been described as a 9/11 effect, a terrorist event charged with historic meaning, transforming the political chemistry in Vienna. Although they were not personally close, the Emperor Franz Joseph was profoundly shocked and upset. It quickly emerged that three leading members of the assassination squad had spent long periods of time in Belgrade, had only recently crossed the border from Serbia, and were carrying weapons and bombs of Serbian manufacture. They were secretly sponsored by the Black Hand, whose objectives included the liberation of all Bosnian Slavs from Austrian rule, and masterminded by the head of Serbian military intelligence. APIs 2 days after the assassination, Foreign Minister Berchtold and the Emperor agreed that the policy of patience with Serbia was at an end. Austria feared that if she displayed weakness, their neighbors to the south and east would be emboldened, whereas war with Serbia would put to an end the problems the dual monarchy had experienced with Serbia. Chief of Staff Konrad stated of Serbia, "If you have a poisonous adder at your heel, you stamp on its head. You don't wait for the bite." There was also a feeling that the moral effects of military action would breathe new life into the exhausted structures of the Habsburg monarchy, restoring it to the vigor and virility of an imagined past, and that Serbia must be dealt with before it became too powerful to defeat militarily. The principal voices for peace in previous years included Franz Ferdinand himself. His removal not only provided the casus belli but removed one of the most prominent doves from policymaking since taking on Serbia involved the risk of war with Russia. Vienna sought the views of Berlin. The Germans provided their unconditional support for war with Serbia, the so-called blank check buoyed up by German support. The Austrians began drawing up an ultimatum, giving the Serbs 48 hours to respond to 10 demands. The Austrians hoped that the ultimatum would be rejected in order to provide the pretext for war with a neighbor they considered to be impossibly turbulent. Samuel R. Williamson has emphasized the role of Austria-Hungary in starting the war. Convinced Serbian nationalism and Russian Balkan ambitions were disintegrating the empire, Austria-Hungary hoped for a limited war against Serbia and that strong German support would force Russia to keep out of the war and weaken its Balkan prestige. At this stage in the crisis, the possibility of determined Russian support for Serbia, and its attendant risks, was never properly weighed up. The Austrians remained fixated on Serbia but did not decide on their precise objectives other than war. Nevertheless, having decided upon war with German support, Austria was slow to act publicly, and did not deliver the ultimatum until July 23, some 3 weeks after the assassinations on 28 June. Thus Austria lost the reflex sympathies attendant to the Sarajevo murders and gave the further impression to the Entente powers that Austria was merely using the assassinations as a pretext Pact for Aggression
blank check.
Germany supports Austria-Hungary on July 6. Germany provided its unconditional support to its ally Austria-Hungary in its quarrel with Serbia, the so-called
blank check.
In response to a request for support, Vienna was told the Kaiser's position was that, if Austria-Hungary recognized the necessity of taking military measures against Serbia, he would deplore our not taking advantage of the present moment, which is so favorable to USWE, might in this case, as in all others, rely upon German support. The thinking was as Austria-Hungary was Germany's only ally, if its prestige was not restored then its position in the Balkans might be irreparably damaged, encouraging further irredentism by Serbia and Romania. A quick war against Serbia would not only eliminate her, but also probably lead to further diplomatic gains vis-à-vis Bulgaria and Romania. A Serbian defeat would also be a defeat for Russia and reduce her influence in the Balkans. The benefits were clear, but there were risks, namely that Russia would intervene and this would lead to a continental war. However, this was thought even more unlikely since the Russians had not yet finished their French-funded rearmament program scheduled for completion in 1917. Moreover, they did not believe that Russia, as an absolute monarchy, would support regicides, and more broadly, the mood across Europe was so anti-Serbian that even Russia would not intervene. Personal factors also weighed heavily, and the German Kaiser was close to the murdered Franz Ferdinand and was affected by his death, to the extent that German councils of restraint vis-à-vis Serbia in 1913 changed to an aggressive stance. On the other hand, the military thought that if Russia did intervene, then St. Petersburg clearly desired war and now would be a better time to fight. When Germany had a guaranteed ally in Austria-Hungary, Russia was not ready and Europe was sympathetic to them on balance. At this point in the crisis, the Germans anticipated that their support would mean the war would be a localized affair between Austria-Hungary and Serbia. This would be particularly true if Austria moved quickly, while the other European powers were still disgusted over the assassinations and therefore likely to be sympathetic to any action Austria-Hungary took. Vermette France backs Russia. French President Raymond Poincaré arrived in St. Petersburg for a state visit on 20 July and departed on 23 July due to the breaking of the Austrian codes. Russia and France were aware of the impending Austrian ultimatum and their meetings were centrally concerned with the crisis unfolding in Central Europe. The French and the Russians agreed their alliance extended to supporting Serbia against Austria, confirming the already established policy behind the Balkan inception scenario. As Christopher Clark notes, Poincaré had come to preach the gospel of firmness and his words had fallen on ready ears. Firmness in this context meant an intransigent opposition to any Austrian measure against Serbia. At no point do the sources suggest that Poincaré or his Russian interlocutors gave any thought whatsoever to what measures Austria-Hungary might legitimately be entitled to take in the aftermath of the assassinations. Russia mobilizes. The crisis escalates on 24-25 July. The Russian Council of Ministers met, and in response to the crisis and despite the fact that she had no alliance with Serbia, agreed to a secret partial mobilization of over 1 million men of the Russian army and the Baltic and Black Sea fleets. It is worth stressing, since this is a cause of some confusion in general narratives of the war, that this was done prior to the Serbian rejection of the ultimatum, the Austrian declaration of war on 28 July, or any military measures taken by Germany as a diplomatic move. This had limited value since the Russians did not make this mobilization public until 28 July. The arguments used to support this move in the Council of Ministers were, the crisis was being used as a pretext by the Germans to increase their power. Acceptance of the ultimatum would mean that Serbia would become a protectorate of Austria. Russia had backed down in the past, for example in the Lehman von Sanders affair and the Bosnian crisis, and this had encouraged the Germans rather than appeased them. Russian arms had recovered sufficiently since the disasters of 1904-06. In addition, Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Sazonov believed that war was inevitable and refused to acknowledge that Austria-Hungary had a right to counter measures in the face of Serbian irredentism. On the contrary, Sazonov had aligned himself with the irredentism, and expected the collapse of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Crucially, the French had provided their clear support for their Russian allies for a robust response in their recent state visit just days before. Also in the background was Russian anxiety of the future of the Turkish Straits, where Russian control of the Balkans would place St. Petersburg in a far better position to prevent unwanted intrusions on the Bosphorus. The policy was intended to be a mobilization against Austria-Hungary only. However, due to Russian incompetence, the Russians realized by 29 July that partial mobilization was not militarily possible, and as it would interfere with general mobilization, only full Mobilization could prevent the entire operation being botched. The Russians therefore moved to full mobilization on 30 July. Christopher Clark stated, "It would be difficult to overstate the historical importance of the meetings of 24 and 25 July, and in taking these steps, Sazonov and his colleagues escalated the crisis and greatly increased the likelihood of a general European war. For one thing, Russian pre-mobilization altered the political chemistry in Serbia, making it unthinkable that the Belgrade government, which had originally given serious consideration to accepting the ultimatum, would back down in the face of Austrian pressure. It heightened the domestic pressure on the Russian administration. It sounded alarm bells in Austria-Hungary. Most importantly of all, these measures drastically raised the pressure on Germany, which had so far abstained from military preparations and was still counting on the localization of the Austro-Serbian conflict. Serbia rejects the ultimatum. Austria declares war on Serbia on 23 July. Austria-Hungary, following their own enquiry into the assassinations, sends an ultimatum to Serbia, containing their demands, giving 48 hours to comply. Serbia initially considered accepting all the terms of the ultimatum before news from Russia of pre-mobilization measures stiffened their resolve. The Serbs drafted their reply to the ultimatum in such a way as to give the impression of making significant concessions, but, as Christopher Clark states, in reality, then, this was a highly perfumed rejection on most points. In response to the rejection of the ultimatum, Austria broke off diplomatic relations on 25 July and declared war on 28 July. Russia. General mobilization is ordered on July 29, 1914. The Tsar ordered full mobilization, then changed his mind after receiving a telegram from Kaiser Wilhelm. Partial mobilization was ordered instead the next day. The Tsar's foreign minister, Sergei Sazonov, once more persuaded Nicholas of the need for general mobilization, and the order was issued that day. July 30. Christopher Clark states, "The Russian general mobilization was one of the most momentous decisions of the July crisis. This was the first of the general mobilizations. It came at the moment when the German government had not yet even declared the state of impending war. Why did Russia do this? In response to the Austrian declaration of war on 28 July, the previously ordered partial mobilization was incompatible with a future general mobilization. Sazonov's conviction that Austrian intransigence was Germany's policy, and therefore given that Germany was driving Austria, there was no longer any point in mobilizing against Austria only. France reiterated her support for Russia, and there was significant cause to think that Britain would also support Russia-German mobilization and war with Russia and France on 28 July. Germany learned through its spy network that Russia had implemented partial mobilization and its period preparatory to war. The Germans assumed that Russia had, after all, decided upon war and that her mobilization put Germany in danger. This was doubly so because German war plans, the so-called Schlieffen Plan, relied upon Germany to mobilize speedily enough to defeat France first by attacking largely through neutral Belgium before turning to defeat the slower-moving Russians. German efforts at mediation, which suggested that Austria should halt in Belgrade and use the occupation of the Serbian capital to ensure its terms were met, were rendered futile by the speed of Russian preparations, which threatened to force the Germans to take countermeasures before mediation could begin to take effect. Thus, in response to Russian mobilization, Germany ordered the state of imminent danger of war SIDW on 31 July, and when the Russian government refused to rescind its mobilization order, Germany mobilized and declared war on Russia on 1 August. Given the Franco-Russian alliance, countermeasures by France were, correctly, assumed to be inevitable, and Germany therefore declared war on France on 3 August 1914. Britain declares war on Germany, 4 August 1914. Following the German invasion of neutral Belgium, Britain issued an ultimatum to Germany on 2 August that she must withdraw or face war. The Germans did not comply and Britain declared war on Germany on 4 August 1914. Britain's reasons for declaring war were complex. The ostensible reason given was that Britain was required to safeguard Belgium's neutrality under the 1839 Treaty of London. The German invasion of Belgium was, therefore, the case belli and, importantly, legitimized and galvanized popular support for the war. Strategic risks posed by German control of the Belgian and ultimately French coast was considered unacceptable. German guarantees of post-war behavior were cast into doubt by her blasé treatment of Belgian neutrality. However, the Treaty of London of 1839 had not committed Britain on her own to safeguard Belgium's neutrality. Moreover, naval war planning demonstrated that Britain herself would have violated Belgian neutrality by blockading her ports to prevent imported goods passing to Germany in the event of war with Germany. Rather, Britain's relationship with her Entente partners, both France and Russia, were equally significant factors. Edward Grey argued that the secret naval agreements with France, although they had not been approved by the cabinet, created a moral obligation vis-à-vis Britain and France. What is more, in the event that Britain abandoned its Entente friends, it was feared that if Germany won the war, or the Entente won without British support, then, either way, Britain would be left without any friends. This would have left both Britain and her empire vulnerable to attack. British Foreign Office Mandarin Air Crow stated, should the war come, and England stand aside, one of two things must happen: either Germany and Austria win, crush France and humiliate Russia. What will be the position of a friendless England be, or France and Russia win? What would be their attitude towards England? What about India and the Mediterranean? Domestically, the Liberal cabinet was split, and in the event that war was not declared, the government would fall as Prime Minister Asquith, Edward Grey and Winston Churchill made it clear they would resign in that event. The existing Liberal cabinet would lose their jobs, since it was likely the pro-war Conservatives would be elected to power. This would lead to a slightly belated British entry into the war in any event, so wavering cabinet ministers were also likely motivated by the desire to avoid senselessly splitting their party and sacrificing their jobs. Domestic political factors. German domestic politics. Left-wing parties, especially the Social Democratic Party of Germany SPD, made large gains in the 1912 German election. German government at the time was still dominated by the Prussian Junkers, who feared the rise of these left-wing parties. Fritz Fischer famously argued that they deliberately sought an external war to distract the population and whip up patriotic support for the government. Indeed, one German military leader said that a war was desirable in order to escape from difficulties at home and abroad, and a Prussian conservative leader even argued that a war would strengthen patriarchal order. Russia was in the midst of a large-scale military build-up and reform that they intended to complete in 1916-1917. Other authors argue that German conservatives were ambivalent about a war, worrying that losing a war would have disastrous consequences, and even a successful war might alienate the population if it were lengthy or difficult. French domestic politics. The situation in France was quite different from that in Germany. In France, war appeared to be a gamble. 40 years after the loss of Alsace-Lorraine, a vast number of French were still angered by it, as well as by the humiliation of being compelled to pay a large reparation to Germany. The diplomatic alienation of France orchestrated by Germany prior to World War I caused further resentment in France. Nevertheless, the leaders of France recognized Germany's military advantage, as Germany had nearly twice the population and a better equipped army. Citation. Needed. At the same time, the episodes of the Tangier crisis in 1905 and the Agadir crisis in 1911 had given France an indication that war with Germany could come if Germany continued to oppose French colonial expansionism. France was politically polarized. The left-wing socialists led by Jean Jaurès pushed for peace against nationalists on the right like Paul Déroulède, who called for revenge against Germany. France in 1914 had never been so prosperous and influential in Europe since 1870, nor its military so strong and confident in its leaders, emboldened by its success in North Africa and the overall pacification of its vast colonial empire. The Entente Cordiale of 1904 with Britain held firm, and was supported by mutual interests abroad and strong economic ties. Russia had fled the Triple Crown alliance with Germany and Austria-Hungary because of disagreements with Austria-Hungary over policy in the Balkans. Russia also hoped that large French investments in its industry and infrastructures, coupled with an important military partnership, would prove themselves profitable and durable. The foreign ministry was filled with expert diplomats, but there was great turnover at the top. In the 18 months before the war, there were 6 foreign ministers. The leadership was prepared to fight Germany and attempt to gain back the provinces of Alsace and Lorraine lost in 1871. It is important to note, however, that France could never have permitted itself to initiate a war with Germany, as its military pact with Britain was only purely defensive. Citation. Needed. The assumption that Germany would not violate neutral Belgium was a serious blunder in French planning. The drivers of Austro-Hungarian policy. The argument that Austro-Hungary was a moribund political entity, whose disappearance was only a matter of time, was deployed by hostile contemporaries to suggest that the Empire's efforts to defend its integrity during the last years before the war were in some sense illegitimate. Clark states, evaluating the prospects of the Austro-Hungarian Empire on the eve of the First World War confronts us in an acute way with the problem of temporal perspective. The collapse of the empire amid war and defeat in 1918 impressed itself upon the retrospective view of the Habsburg lands, overshadowing the scene with auguries of imminent and ineluctable decline. It is true that in Austro-Hungary, the political scene of the last decades before the war were increasingly dominated by the struggle for national rights among the empire's 11 official nationalities: German, Hungarians, Czechs, Slovaks, Slovenes, Croats, Serbs, Romanians, Ruthenians, Poles and Italians. Yet before 1914, radical nationalists seeking full separation from the empire were still in a small minority, and the roots of Austro-Hungary's political turbulence went less deep than appearances suggested. In fact, during the pre-war decade, the Habsburg lands passed through a phase of strong economic growth with a corresponding rise in general prosperity. Most inhabitants of the empire associated the Habsburg state with the benefits of orderly government, public education, welfare, sanitation, the rule of law, and the maintenance of a sophisticated infrastructure. Christopher Clark states, "Prosperous and relatively well administered, the empire, like its elderly sovereign, exhibited a curious stability amid turmoil. Crises came and went without appearing to threaten the existence of the system. As such, the situation was always, as the Viennese journalist Karl Kraus quipped, desperate but not serious imperialism." See also, New Imperialism. Marxists typically attributed the start of the war to imperialism. Imperialism, argued Lenin, is the monopoly stage of capitalism. He thought the monopoly capitalists went to war to control markets and raw materials. Britain, especially with its vast worldwide British Empire, was a main example, although it entered the war later than the other key players on the issue of Belgium. Britain also had an informal empire based on trade in neutral countries. It grew rich in part from its success in trade in foreign resources, markets, territories, and people, and Germany was jealous because its much smaller empire was much poorer. John Darwin argues the British Empire was distinguished by the adaptability of its builders. Darwin says, "The hallmark of British imperialism was its extraordinary versatility in method, outlook and object. The British tried to avoid military action in favour of reliance on networks of local elites and businessmen who voluntarily collaborated and in turn gained authority and military protection from British recognition. France, Germany, the Netherlands, and Italy all hoped to emulate the British model, and the United States became a latecomer in 1898. In all countries, the quest for national prestige strengthened imperial motives, their frustrated ambitions, and British policies of strategic exclusion created tensions. Commercial interests contributed substantially to rivalries during the scramble for Africa. After 1880, Africa became the scene of sharpest conflict between certain French, German and British imperial interests. Rivalries for not just colonies, but colonial trade and trade routes developed between the emerging economic powers and the incumbent great powers. Although still argued differently according to historical perspectives on the path to war, this rivalry was illustrated in the Berlin-Baghdad Railway, which would have given German industry access to Mesopotamia's suspected rich oil fields, and extensive asphalt deposits, as well as German trade a southern port in the Persian Gulf. A history of this railroad describes the German interests in countering the British Empire at a global level, and Turkey's interest in countering their Russian rivals at a regional level, as stated by a contemporary man on the ground at the time. Jastra wrote, "It was felt in England that if, as Napoleon is said to have remarked, Antwerp in the hands of a great continental power was a pistol levelled at the English coast, Baghdad and the Persian Gulf in the hands of Germany or any other strong power would be a 42-centimetre gun pointed at India." On the other side, public opinion in Germany was feasting on visions of Cairo, Baghdad, and Tehran, and the possibility of evading the British blockade through outlets to the Indian Ocean. Britain's initial strategic exclusion of others from northern access to a Persian Gulf port in the creation of Kuwait by treaty as a protected, subsidized client state showed political recognition of the importance of the issue. On June 15, 1914, Britain and Germany signed an agreement on the issue of the Baghdad Railway, which Britain had earlier signed with Turkey, to open access to its use, to add British representation on the board of the railway, and restrict access by rail to the Persian Gulf. The railway issue did not play a role in the failed July 1914 negotiations, but remains as a concrete illustration of the underlying economic threat to Britain's dominance in colonial trade, and the rivalry of German industry. Kaiser Wilhelm II. In 1902, Germany's leader Otto von Bismarck disliked the idea of an overseas empire, but pursued a colonial policy in response to domestic political demands. Bismarck supported French colonization in Africa because it diverted government attention and resources away from Continental Europe and Revanchism. After 1890, Bismarck's successor, Leo von Caprivi, was the last German chancellor who was successful in calming Anglo-German tensions. After Caprivi left office in 1894, Germany's bellicose new course in foreign affairs was controlled by Kaiser Wilhelm, bombastic and impetuous. The Kaiser made tactless pronouncements on sensitive topics without consulting his ministers, culminating in a disastrous Daily Telegraph interview that cost him most of his power inside the German government. In 1908, Langer et al. 1968 emphasized the negative international consequences of Wilhelm's erratic personality. He believed in force, and the survival of the fittest in domestic as well as foreign politics. William was not lacking in intelligence, but he did lack stability, disguising his deep insecurities by swagger and tough talk. He frequently fell into depressions and hysterics. William's personal instability was reflected in vacillations of policy. His actions, at home as well as abroad, lacked guidance, and therefore often bewildered or infuriated public opinion. He was not so much concerned with gaining specific objectives, as had been the case with Bismarck, as with asserting his will. This trait in the ruler of the leading continental power was one of the main causes of the uneasiness prevailing in Europe at the turn of the century. The status of Morocco had been guaranteed by international agreement, and when France attempted to greatly expand its influence there without the assent of all the other signatories, Germany opposed it, prompting the Moroccan crises, the Tangier crisis of 1905, and the Agadir crisis of 1911. The intent of German policy was to drive a wedge between the British and French, but in both cases produced the opposite effect, and Germany was isolated diplomatically, most notably lacking the support of Italy. Despite Italian membership in the Triple Alliance, the French protectorate over Morocco was established officially in 1912. In 1914, however, the African scene was peaceful. The continent was almost fully divided up by the imperial powers, with only Liberia and Ethiopia still independent. There were no major disputes there pitting any two European powers against each other. Social Darwinism. By the late 19th century, a new school of thought, later known as Social Darwinism, became popular among intellectuals and political leaders. It emphasized that competition was natural in a biological sense. In nature, there was the survival of the fittest organism, and so too in political geography, the fittest nation would win out. Nationalism made it a competition between peoples, nations, or races rather than kings and elites. Social Darwinism carried a sense of inevitability to conflict and downplayed the use of diplomacy or international agreements to end warfare. It tended to glorify warfare, taking the initiative and the warrior male role. Social Darwinism played an important role across Europe, but J. Leslie has argued that it played a critical and immediate role in the strategic thinking of some important, hawkish members of the Austro-Hungarian government.